Hey guys, what's going on? This is your boy Christian Israel, and you are listening to the New Creation Capital Podcast. Today is Tuesday, March 31st, and we've got the next part of story coming to you. This is episode 8, and we thank you guys for listening. If you haven't followed yet, follow. If you haven't liked yet, please like if you like the content, as well as subscribe. And more importantly, please share, because only way for this to get out is for you, the listener, to share with others. So I really appreciate it. Thank you for starting to converse with me on my Twitter page, at New Creation Cap. And let's jump into what's going on today. Before we go into the story of the day, I want to go back and again and just thank everybody on the front line that is doing this. I know this is getting crazy, crazy, crazy. We now have over 36,000 deaths worldwide. And I'm not going to really touch on the topic. I just want you guys to look into what exponential growth is for all of those who are in the other world. Yes, I keep saying what Robert Emanuel said about don't let a crisis go to waste. True, but it's still a crisis, guys. So let's pray for those who are out there fighting it. You know, not just the doctors and the nurses and the cops and the paramedics and the firemen. I've seen firemen and paramedics a lot in my neighborhood recently when I normally never saw them. So obviously things are going on. I know in my own area they're saying 10 cases are confirmed. But we also know there's just not enough testing kits out there because one person has already died. So people are dying. Mothers, sisters, brothers, cousins, uncles, grandparents. They're all passing away. So let's just pray so we can get through this. We also know, quick up-to-date news, that the White House here in the United States has extended their social distancing policy until April 30th. So at least another month. So we've got some time to be on lockdown. And while we're on lockdown, we're continuing to look into what we talked about in episode 7, which was what is Ripple and what is XRP? And we talked about in that video a little bit, to sum it up, the protocol, what Ripple is, how they're used, and what the XRP token is used for on the just kind of an overview of what it's used for. But then we mentioned who Chris Larsen is and how they finished with a video yesterday talking about they want to build the internet of value. So today, again, shout out to BankXRP on YouTube because he's got a great foundation of all this, I call it back shadow videos, where you have Chris Larsen speaking at the Lendit Fintech Festival on April of 2018, okay? And he's here at this conference speaking about it. And today, kind of how I played that Christine Lagarde keynote speech for you, we're going to play that today with Chris Larsen speaking about it. And then tomorrow we'll break it down. It's about a 21-minute video, but I believe to hear these people's voices are better than me saying it. So let's hear him say it, and then I'll break it down for you later, okay? Thank you guys for tuning in. I hope you guys get a lot out of this, and then we can really, really break it down. If you don't know how we got here, each episode builds upon itself. Episode 1 started with the stimulus bill, the COVID-19 stimulus bill, when it introduced the digital dollar to America and the U.S. system and the Fed accounts and the Fed Reserve, and now we're moving forward. We got other accounts that are talking about relevant news, which we'll get there eventually, but we're talking about how we got to today. Knowing your history and how we got to today with the digital dollar. Was it planned? It was the whole point of the start of this New Creation Capital podcast. So thank you guys so much for tuning in, and that's it. Remember, this is a new you. A new future, a new creation. Let's dive into today's story, guys.
For the old timers in the room who've been around the online lending space for many years, this person has had a high profile since, about 13 years ago. He was the co-founder and CEO of Prosper. He left Prosper in, I think it was 2012. I got to know him a little bit during that time. And he's gone on to his next, and he just told me backstage, his definitely last startup, and that's Ripple. And what Ripple's trying to do, they're really trying to enable a new payment system, a new global payment system, and really a rethinking of how value is exchanged around the world. And so Chris Larsen is the executive chairman and co-founder of Ripple, and he's going to come on stage with Joanne Barefoot, who is the founder of Barefoot Integration Group and is also a very high profile and has done some tremendous work in this space in sort of shining a light on a lot of regulatory issues. So please join me in welcoming Chris Larsen and Joanne Barefoot.
Everyone. Chris, you and I have known each other for maybe 6 or 7 years. I didn't know you at Elon or Prosper, but I did know you when Ripple was OpenCoin. And we were at a dinner in New York a few years ago that was about fintech, very fascinating group of people around the table. And I remember saying that of all the people there, and the amazing and cool things that everybody was doing, that the one who was the most likely to change the world was you. Because Ripple has this breathtakingly ambitious view of how we should transform payments and commerce and how we live through interoperability and through new technology rails. So I want to start by just asking you to talk broadly about this vision. We've got 20 minutes. I'm hoping that everyone will get a chance to hear your most insightful thinking on where we are going, should be going, how we're going to get there.
Well, first of all, thank you for being so gracious. Very kind words. And thank you to Peter. It's great to see him again. But, you know, obviously there is a ton of noise within the blockchain space. You know, the thing could, you know, cure every ill in the world. And, you know, the truth is 90% of it is utter nonsense that's going to go away for sure. But what comes of that, I think this is a fundamental shift in fintech. And what we believe the big thing happening here is the development of a second internet. We call it the internet of value. So that value, money, assets will begin moving as quickly and efficiently as data has been moving for the last 25 years. And we think that is profound in what it's going to do to the world. So while a lot of the attention in blockchain is around new currencies, digital assets, and certainly we, you know, work on and advocate for digital assets, XRP is the one that we've really gotten behind, that's really just a subset of a much bigger thing happening. And so really, I think you're leading into a world where there'll be complete interoperability between all the money systems, ledgers, networks of the world. And that's really what's missing today. So for example, we all know, you know, wealthy people, people in developing countries. I mean, we can't even really send $50 to Europe without it being all chewed up in fees. That's clearly a problem. Much bigger problem is the 2 billion people living in the developing world who need, according to the Gates Foundation, need to be able to send 50 cents to really be participants in the global economy. You can't do that in a system that's run by SWIFT and correspondent banking, where we all know it might take 3 days to move value between countries, and where there's high failure rates and the costs are very high. So, you know, we've been in the money world, we're living in a pre-internet world where, you know, before we had email, it was very expensive to communicate. You know, imagine sending letters. You know, nobody does that anymore. Using SWIFT is like sending a letter. You know, when you dropped it in the mailbox, you have no idea where it is, if it got there or not. So getting away from that, I think, is profound. And what we would say is that, you know, a lot of the backlash on globalization today, it's not because globalization is bad. It's essential. It's that it's incomplete. Because globalization needs kind of three key systems to be working together. And it needs interoperability and data. You know, check that one. We've had that since the internet IP, 25 years now. You need interoperability in goods. We've had that since the 50s with the shipping container. We've talked about shipping. We love shipping containers.
We're going to come back to that.
That was key. But you don't have it yet in money. And, you know, you need data, goods, and money to all be globally operating. And that's coming. So that's the profound thing. The neat thing about when we talk about blockchain, while it's not the digital assets themselves that can ever be the network of networks, because, you know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, XRP's ledger, they're all just networks. So that can never be the network of networks. But what they did is they created this thing. We believe the winner will be ILP, the Interledger Protocol, which we think is equivalent to IP that changed data and to that shipping container that changed goods. So that's a really profound thing that will play out over the next, pick some number, 1, 2, 5, 10 years. It's happening right now.
Take a moment and talk about the shipping container analogy, because I think it's really helpful to people. I did a podcast with Chris. My podcast show is Barefoot Innovation, which is on iTunes if you want to hear it. And you talked about the book, The Box, and the fact that the shipping container standardization changed everything about global commerce. Just take a moment to talk about that metaphor.
Sure. Shouldn't get excited about shipping containers, but you know, they're very simple things. But that kind of is the point, right? Any kind of global standard or protocol needs to be super simple and basic, super low level, because that's the only way it's going to be adopted by everyone. It's going to be adopted by Europeans, Americans, Chinese, Japanese economy. And a shipping container is super basic. A shipping container is not a shipping company. There is no way one shipping company, no matter how efficient, will dominate the world. It's going to be hundreds of shipping companies, all with different features for the Nordic countries than what you'd see in Latin America, for example. Shipping container is super basic. And why it's so profound is, before the shipping container, of course, shipping goods was super labor intensive, super inefficient, like moving money is today. You'd send stuff to a port. It had to be unpacked right there at the port, repacked. It was a huge drag on global commerce. And then along comes a shipping container, so the goods stay in that container at the point of manufacturing, sent right to their local port through a truck, a train, then to a ship, back to another ship, another train, another truck, interoperable in any port around the world. And when that was created in the 1950s, 700% increase in global trade, completely transformed ports everywhere, created a Cambrian explosion of new types of shipping companies. It's exactly what you saw with the internet, by the way, and it's exactly what you're going to see with a very low level. Again, that can't be Bitcoin or Ethereum or the XRP ledger. That will be a part of what happens here. But those things are heavy, they're thick, they're shipping companies with certain features that will never be acceptable to everybody in the world. You need something super low level, something like the interledger protocol is what, again, what we believe in, which is super basic. Is not, it's not a ledger, and just like it's not a shipping company, but something that the Chinese can get behind, you can get something in the developing world could get behind, Gates Foundation could get behind, which they have, the Americans could get behind. Very basic, very simple. And also, very importantly, you know, if you deploy a shipping container in Los Angeles, the port of Los Angeles, it has no effect on the shipping container being used in Amsterdam. Or whatever the port is there. That's not true with databases. One additional entry to the Bitcoin ledger or to HSBC's ledger creates scalability issues to everything else in the system. That's why that can't work to be that network of networks.
You mentioned the Gates Foundation, and you have a project in the developing world, or focused on the developing world, called Moja Loop, which I believe Moja is the Swahili name for one. Talk a little bit about that and about the potential for this transformation to actually connect everyone in the world to mainstream commercial activity.
Yeah, we're super excited to have been able to work with and continue to work with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They've been incredible leaders in so many things, but also a lot of people don't know there are about 1,200 people working on financial inclusion. So kind of second to what they've been doing so amazingly with disease prevention. And they see that as a absolutely key thing that happens on Earth. And I think they share this view that sort of in the worst kind of situation right now in the world, where everybody has this, you know, kind of amazing future and data about how great life could be on their phone. But again, until you have the interoperability of money, which we don't have yet for 2 billion people, you can kind of, you're tantalized by it, but you can't act on it. That's a huge problem, right? So they know that we need you know, this key interoperability, this very basic infrastructure layer that links M-Pesa to Bank of America to you know, to what's going on at the Japanese financial system, and you don't have that, right? That's what's blocking a key thing happening here. And I think they agreed also that you need something like the interledger protocol. That's what's baked into Moja Loop, as well as many other very specific technologies that would help banks and central banks and governments in the developing world to you know, really kind of leap ahead. One interesting thing about, I think, their view as well is a lot of people in blockchain kind of seem to talk about it's going to go around the banks, it's going to go around governments, screw all the laws. People that work in financial inclusion, they take the exact opposite role, that the only way that you're going to have impact is if you work within the system, that it's appropriately regulated. And if you really, people in the developing world, they want to establish, they don't want to be anonymous, they want to establish histories so they can build credit and so that people can know who they are, so you can have trust on both sides. So it's been great working with them, and we just think they're doing fantastic work.
And people have phones. I think since 2013, there have been more people in the world with cell phones than plumbing.
Yeah.
And we're wrapped, the World Bank has a gap that every adult in the world should have a so-called bank account in their phone by 2020. Don't think we're going to hit 2020, but we're going to hit it in the 2020s. So the technology is converging. Everybody's got the device in their hand if we can just figure out how to make the system connect them.
Yeah, we have so many of the component parts that are in place, but the kind of the cell phone represents kind of two of the components, right? It's, gives you a lot of the application layer on the top, right? Just like, Facebook and Google on the web. It gives you a lot of the databases or ledgers through the phone companies, perhaps, or through banks at the bottom. But there's that missing layer of what is the IP, what is the shipping container that's going to wire them all together. And that's the part, thankfully, that's being introduced. Now, when you combine then those new apps, those new devices, those new databases with an interoperability layer, boom. I mean, that changes the world overnight. And I think we're so close to that. And that will create this Cambrian explosion of, so many of the companies here that will suddenly have this global platform to be working on, which will make fintech so much easier. Everybody in fintech knows how difficult it is just within a country, let alone to try to go global. That is all about to change, and that's great for everybody.
And I've heard you talk about the potential then for, as you're saying, an explosion of economic development, which is why the developing world central banks and regulators are so much behind all this, because we'll have markets of billions of people who are not connected to markets today.
Yeah, it will create huge economic growth, just like that shipping container did, just like the internet connecting 3 billion people and growing, a 20% increase in global GDP in about 5 years. So the implications here are huge. And governments have really been getting behind this. That's what's really encouraging. In 2014, it was a kind of dark days for regulation and blockchain in space. Now, I think the regulators are getting behind systems that make sense, like interoperability, and getting behind digital assets. Because, the cryptocurrencies, the digital assets, whatever you want to call them, they also play a key role in that. Once you get the plumbing in place, those new types of assets that have no counterparties create incredible efficiencies to reduce capital that has to otherwise be kept by banks all over the world. Could be used for IoT, because again, probably once you get that infrastructure in place, most payments will be machine to machine. So that also kind of, again, once you solve the developing world problem, that also solves the IoT problem. So the explosion in the number of transactions is tremendous, and that drives a lot of the demand for digital assets, which regulators and banks are getting behind now.
So you mentioned the sort of legacy thinking and some of the early fintech of, how did you put it, screw the regulators or something like that. And of course, Bitcoin itself started on a very anti-government philosophy. And part of what Ripple has done is try to bring these innovations into a regulated framework. So I'd like to ask you, with the time we have left, to talk a little bit about regulatory issues. Mm-hmm. How are you thinking about ICOs? We have Mark Zuckerberg on the Hill today talking about privacy. Do you have advice from the policy standpoint on how these new technologies should be, can best be regulated?
Yeah, I mean, I think all new technologies start with screw the government, disruption, tear everything down. So I think that's natural. And then, the internet started that way too, and then it has to sort of grow up, and particularly as it's solving real world problems are always more complicated than that. And then when you switch to finance, this is different, right? This is, the internet was mostly technology, and now it's just now kind of crashing into regulatory issues. The Internet of Value is fundamentally tech, capital markets, and compliance, kind of in equal amounts. And if you look at the companies that are really doing things, you'll see their teams are kind of, you know, they have heavy, big teams in all three of those. And the trick here is kind of mixing those all up together. So companies need to start from day one having chief compliance officers and compliance staffs and working with regulators, and that's natural. You know, people are going to still work through companies, whether that be banks or payment providers. They're not going to run, you know, their own banks and on their phone with nobody else, no more than they run their own email servers. They use Gmail, right? So I think that's the way it's going to play out. Good news is that we are in the best fintech regulatory environment of all time. This is awesome. You know, we know how bad it can get, right? So this is it's a great time. I think on some of the other things like ICOs, we're pretty anti-ICO. I think it's a bad thing to get involved with from the founder's perspective, because, you know, if you're a founder and you can raise money many ways today, do you really want to do something where you're going to have the SEC, you know, kind of threat hanging over your head for 10 years with strict liability? You just don't want that. You know, that's a problem. For investors, I think because companies can raise money anywhere these days, so it's a good idea, there's got to be some adverse selection if they're choosing an ICO. So I think that's a negative for the investors in these things. And then finally, from building currencies, digital assets, ICOs typically say, okay, this is a currency for this use case and none other. That's kind of the opposite of the way it should go. Currencies need to be as liquid as possible, and so they need to have as many use cases as possible. For XRP, for example, the kind of early beachhead has been cross-border payments, but we see that as just the beginning of something that really has a multitude of use cases to get as liquid as possible. That's what drives utility and value at the end of the day. So I think on all fronts, ICOs are problematic, and that's why you're seeing the regulators crack down on them. Not everywhere, but I think they'll be transformed. They'll probably look like, you know, IPOs at the end of the day. Privacy thing lastly, I think just no question, we are in a market failure on privacy. And when you have market failures, government has to step in and regulate. I think that's going to happen. I think the state of privacy is it's in a bad place right now and needs new rules. It can't be done through self-regulation. That's already failed, just like it did back in the day when we were doing privacy around banks. So I suspect you're going to see new laws come out. There's a very good California proposition called the California Consumer Privacy Act, which will get the signatures. That will be on the ballot in November, and that really goes to the heart of some of the egregious things that are going on, I think, in kind of collecting all this data of ours without giving us choice. So I think that is coming. We should all be prepared for more privacy regulation.
Do you have a view on the European privacy and consumer data efforts? They've been more forward-leaning than we have been here.
Europeans have been great. They've been way ahead of the curve here. They're exactly right, and Americans have been super flip. And Silicon Valley has done a pathetic job on privacy, just dismissing it out of hand, you know, all the famous quotes we've heard. So Americans are way behind. We got to do a lot more.
Maybe the last thing I want to ask you is to sum up. So we have a group of here. We're early in the conference. People are going to be deluged with thoughts and information and ideas. If you wanted the people in the audience to remember one thing from this session that you hope they'll take back and put to use, what would that be?
Well, I mean, the biggest thing we think is super exciting that we're on the cusp of an Internet of Value. So that's going to play out in a way that's very good for all of us. And I think a lot of that will be headquartered right here in the Valley. That's going to provide a ton of new business opportunities. The other thing that I'd say, I always tell, because I made this mistake early on, is like we all start these businesses based on what we see, which is usually consumer. Look at enterprise. Enterprise, you know, the consumer is like on the surface of the water, and there's just this huge thing under, you know, kind of under the surface for enterprise. Fantastic opportunities. So don't ignore enterprise, even if it's not in front of you.
We've talked before about once you have digital currency, which can work in micro payment denominations, of any denomination. I think one of the things you've talked about is we could be doing things like putting sensors on systems that can generate income streams, unlike anything we have today.
No, I think once we have an internet of value layered on top of the internet of data, data and money are going to be moving together in little packets of information, and not just in digital assets, but in fiat currencies. That's really, really exciting. That will change models. You know, if devices become the biggest consumers of payments, for example, and they're doing searches on Google, how does a device, take in an ad? So that's going to change things there, too. But very, very exciting what's coming.
We are out of time, and I just want to ask the audience to join in thanking you for your wonderful remark.
Thank you.
All right, guys. Well, that's the end of this specific episode. End of episode 8. Tomorrow, we will break down what Chad Larsen said and kind of go over the things, you know, the shipping and the moving of the money and so forth. And before I go, an article just came out on Bitcoin.com. It's written by Kevin Helms, and I'll put it in the link below on the anchor part of it. I think if you're on Google Podcasts or Apple, it kind of shows these links as well. But it says here that the IMF declares global recession, 80 countries request help, trillions of dollars needed. It says the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, has declared that we have entered a global recession, one that is as bad as or worse than the previous global financial crisis. 80 countries have already requested emergency assistance from the IMF. Meanwhile, the G20 has reported fiscal measures totaling some $5 trillion, or over 6% of the total global GDP. All right, so things are happening already. Things are moving. And we heard, the IMF chief now is Kristalina Georgieva, who is now the IMF chief. So we're going to kind of continue to go through that, but we heard that it needs to be more simple. We need to have on-demand liquidity. You heard him say, and I'll go more on this tomorrow. We'll break it down minute by minute of the conversation, that it's all going to have to happen together. It's not just going to be one thing, but XRP is that payment source. XRP is how we're going to do it, and we're going to work with the regulators. Privacy is no good. If you don't work with the regulators, you're not going to work. Well, the ultimate regulator outside of the U.S. Congress and the Senate and the House and the presidency and the Treasury is the IMF. They are the ones that are going to help move everything. And so right now, this article says our current estimate for the finance needs of emerging markets is $2.5 trillion. That's crazy because we just did $6 trillion as a country. So if these other countries need $2.5 trillion, we're printing money. You know it's going to have to work overall in the favor of a technology that helps everything move. So I know we have a little bit of bump today in some of the market caps. As of today, as of recording, again, we recorded this the day before, so it's about 5:22 p.m. on March 30th, but I'll be saying it's March 31st tomorrow. I think it's 31 days, not April 1st. I don't think it's tomorrow. But as we go right now, the market cap sits at $180 billion. I think we're up $6 billion from yesterday. And we can see that in the market because as of right now, Bitcoin is up 9.37%, sitting directly at $6,540 as we speak. It's been a nice little green candle day. And then Ethereum is up 5.84%, sitting at $133. XRP is up 5.29%, sitting at 17.2 cents. Again, Tether is down 0.22%. That's 2 days in a row now. It's been down right under a dollar at 99 cents. We can go and look at some of the other things. We got Tezos up 8.68%, Monero up 5%, Bitcoin SV up 12.65%, sitting at 169. Bitcoin Cash up 7.76% at 222. So everything seems to be up now. I'm going to check and see if anything is down here. Let's see here. We got three coins down, three of them, and they all look to be stable coins, my friends. Binance USD, which is a 35 ranked coin, is down 0.66%, sitting under 99 cents. True USD is down 0.36%, sitting at 99 cents. Tether is down 0.22%, sitting at 99 cents. So a lot of those things seem to be pumping and money moving back in with $117 billion worth of volume going on, 65.8% dominance moving on. And as I speak, Bitcoin is still pumping. So before I go, I kind of want to see what is going on in the regular stock market. I know we've had all that movement, but let's just see what's going on here. As my computer loads, we have the S&P is currently up on the day at 3.35%, up $85 to $26.26. The NASDAQ is also up 3.96%, up 300 points, sitting at $78.89. Crude oil's up 0.82%, now up 0.16 cents, up to $20. Gold is down. It's moving down and up and down and up as I try to give you a price. 0.29%, sitting around 1617. And then we also have, last but not least, we have the Dow Jones, which is up 3.19%, $690 basis of 22,327. So we see this right now. You know, I know people want to say there's some decoupling with the markets and the crypto market and the stock market, but right now we seem to be pretty correlated and moving together. We seem to be moving. When the stock market goes up, we go up. When the stock market goes down, we go down. So right now, until we get through this COVID-19 crisis, we're kind of sitting in the same exact position. So besides that, I want to know how you guys are doing. How was your weekend? Tell me something fun. There's just a lot of crappy news out right now, honestly. So I want to hear from you. If you tell me something fun, give me some information. Thank you to the subscribers on our YouTube channel, by the way. I've started putting these podcasts on our YouTube channel, New Creation Capital YouTube, at New Creation Cap Twitter. We're also on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Breaker, and Anchor, and about 8 other platforms, including the Brave platform that I talk, or the Brave is our internet browser that we like to use, but the Publix platform, which is also a cryptocurrency platform. You know, just trying to figure out ways. Strange, I barely have any money on my Coinbase account, but I staked Tezos for like 5 seconds, and I'm still getting money from Tezos. I had like 3 cents left in there, and now I'm up to like 40 cents. So we're making money there. That's actually a nice little gain from getting staked back. So I don't know how you guys feel about staked coins and proof of work coins, but hey, they're giving some return right now. Definitely in an up and down market, I'll take the return. Before we go, as always, I am going to read just a little bit of scripture. I think it's pretty interesting because it's going to come out of, let's see here. I'm just going to open my Bible up and see what I get here. Here we go. I came up on Proverbs 16:32, and here's how it goes. Better a patient person than a warrior, one with self-control than a one who takes a city. Wow. If that doesn't work when you're an investor, patience is much better than diving right on in, right? As Warren Buffett also says, right, I think his quote is, the stock market is basically a transfer of wealth from the inpatient to the patient. And right there, that's the proverb right there in the word, backing you up. I hope you guys are out there being patient. I hope you guys are enjoying your day. Thank you very much. Again, shout out to everybody on the front lines right now. I know we just extended this thing until, looks like Los Angeles just extended it till June. So, guys, good luck out there. I know in my county, we now have 4 more cases. I'm in a slightly smaller county, but my state has another 800 cases in it. So even down in Alabama's getting hit. If you didn't hear also, the Chinese have reclosed their theaters after opening up. So I don't know what you guys think about that. You think they really are talking about the real stats here? We'll see. But besides that, guys, thank you for listening. Bitcoin is still pumping right now, 65.67. It is a pump city, 5,900 as it was last night, which is right on my target, all the way up $600 more. So hope you guys are out there making money. Now remember to buy low and sell high. This is Christian Israel, a New Creation Capital Podcast. This is a new you, a new future, and a new creation. Thanks, you guys, for listening. As always, peace and love. Until next time.